The gospel, according to Mark, dictates, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to all nations. As a part of the Adente missionary community, our guest today, Father Luis Miguel Romero, lives this mandate. Born in Spain, Father Luis is an author of biology, ethics, theology, and numerous other topics. Father Romero is the pastor at Our Lady of Loreto in Hempstead, and today he will share with us his vocation story here on It's a Wonderful Life. Welcome back to It's a Wonderful Life. We're joined here today by the pastor of Our Lady of Loreto Parish in Hempstead, Father Luis Miguel Romero. Father Luis, welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here.
Well, you have an incredible story in your walk and journey, your vocation story. You're not from Hempstead, right? You grew up in Spain, and you're part of the Adente missionary community. Can you tell us a little bit about growing up in Spain, but also the community?
Yeah, well, maybe the way of explaining about the community is more about what our founding father, Fernando Riello, said one day.
Yes.
In a special feeling, it's not the definition. He said, the intermissionary is the one who goes throughout the world, sometimes laughing, sometimes crying, praying always,
right.
And mainly dreaming in the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Mm, beautiful.
So this is what we feel. And more technically, we are the core of our charism is the fact that we are children of God, the divine filiation, and two pastoral missions: the promoting the faith among the intellectuals, and dialogue with the intellectuals and promoting the faith with the young people, especially those who are far from the church.
Yes.
So this is part of our, and this has been part of my story. I have spent my whole life in general in universities. That is not the place where the Christ is, unfortunately, more present nowadays.
Right. And I would say, speaking to the intellectual, you have some resume. Your curriculum vitae is pretty impressive from the standpoint of your studies, because not only did you study philosophy and theology, biology, ethics. Can you speak a little bit about that experience?
Well, I started studying biology. It is interesting because it was a moment where biology was the landmark of atheism in the end of the 60s and the early 70s, where Jack Monod published the famous book, The Chance and the Necessity, where everything is defined by the molecules and that's
right.
It.
Right.
It was not so easy in that moment because the imaginary was so powerful. People really believed that it was so easy. Even two molecules could define the human being, that's it. And I was in that spirit. I entered in the community at the same time as I started biology.
Right.
And I was studying in parallel philosophy and theology and with my studies of biology. What is normal in our community? Because we need to promote this dialogue and we need to know what is the human and divine science. You know?
And so often the modern world pushes back that the Catholic Church is not on the front lines of the intellect. And so clearly you, with your own personal study, but being on the campuses in the universities, you had to do that.
Yeah, not only, sometimes people say that the church is not, but church is strongly in the middle of everywhere in the world. Something different is what the communications are trying to, the media, are trying to make us to believe. Right. And this is not true. At least it has not been my experience. Even with a dialogue with many intellectuals, in some of them very good ones, most of them are believers or they have a respect for faith. No? So, and they have their own struggle seeking for truth, and they are contemplating this dimension also in the faith. No? So it is not like the idea that we used to have. And even the young people, it's the same. No?
Absolutely.
The young people are seeking something deeper. What they don't like is what is superficial. No? It was in the case of my life. My vocation came in that context because I was not very... I studied in the Catholic school, not in the high school, but in the elementary and medium school.
Right.
It was the school of the town, small town.
Yes.
And it was a Jesuit school. No? So I had a certain formation, but later on, the message that I received from faith was that I have to be a well-behaved boy, not very, not pushing, not seeking strongly,
right.
But for a young man in that moment with blood in my veins, yeah. This is not the message that I wanted to receive from faith. No? So I kept the faith in a side. Yes. And even I was seeking for Eastern religion, like Hinduism and Buddhism. It was.
Yeah. You're experimenting.
Yeah, well, it was the times also. Remember that the Beatles were then in India with Ravi Shankar.
Yes,
and
yes.
This was this context, no? The forbidden paths to Kathmandu, all these contexts. No? And but I somehow perceived through that experience that religion is an ideal. Hmm. It's not a moral to fulfill,
right.
Moral issues to fulfill. It's an ideal. No, in this context, when I discovered Christ as an ideal, that someone showed me through some sentences very, very powerful, or with me or against me, the one who don't gather with me scatters.
Right.
If you are not, you are warm, lukewarm, you are not cold right. Or hot, I'm going to vomit you. So
right.
Be
tough
holy
words.
As
tough
your
words.
Heavenly Father is holy. So I was impressed. I said, I like this Christ.
Mm.
And then I became, not that I was going to say a missionary, but no, I didn't know what was that. I became to follow Christ.
Yes.
This encounter was real. And when I go in the gospel, in the book of Revelation, about this first moment of charity, it was for me so meaningful. That moment was so deep, so clear, so profound, that I can resume all my life in that moment.
Wow. Well, I mean, you spoke a little bit about like this, I'll use that term, experimentation or exploring. As a missionary, it started for you in Spain, but you didn't really spend a lot of time in Spain as part of the community. You were down in Latin America and India. Can you speak a little bit to that experience before you came to us here on Long Island?
Oh, yes, thank you. Our mission is everywhere.
Sure.
But for a missionary, the moment when you are transferred abroad is a very meaningful moment. Mm-hmm. Even I remember to spend overnight in my flight to Bolivia, that was the first place, I couldn't sleep. I was awake, dreaming, right. And trying to figure out what was that. You know? And the experience is incredible because you have the experience of the greatness of the world and the people around the world in all the dimensions I found. You know? Especially I was then in the context of the Catholic University. Mm. No, I was in charge of the campus ministry there. And it was a very meaningful moment with young people dreaming something important in their lives. And even still now, I am in contact with them, and there has passed more than 30 years.
Right.
Some of them are now in the political context, trying to dream a new Bolivia with deep values, and some others have empowered their lives in many ways. No? So it was very important in that moment. No? And then I was transferred to Chile. I had the experience of the maturity of the young people there and the Catholic young people with the spirit of San Albert Hurtado, no? That was somehow a kind of reference for the youth there. And there, for example, in the Catholic University, they were having a kind of missions in the country. And then we repeated when I was transferred to Ecuador, in our university, in Ecuador Catholic University there, we developed something like that. We called that a country mission. Mm-hmm. And we sent 500 university students around the country to many towns and villages in the jungle, in the mountains, in the seashore, and it was especially interesting.
Father, we have about a minute left in our time here, so now we bring you to Long Island. What would be a message that you would say in those similar journeys that you had in Latin America and even in India? What would you say to our young people to encourage them, not only to grow closer in their faith in Christ, but even to open up a life of Christ?
Well, if I would have to choose one word and one message of Pope Francis, I would choose the address of Pope Francis to young people in Cuba, when he spoke to them about dreaming.
Yes.
So for me, it's the most meaningful word. I agree with the idea that vocations is not a question of pushing. It's a question of it's something that is promoted by attraction. And by attraction, because you are dreaming, many young people can join your dreams.
Yes.
And then they can share your way. And some of them can say, well, it deserves, as I did, my whole life, because it's very important. This is what I used to say to our people in Loreto.
And so the message for us as Catholics is that to be dreamers, that the Lord has instilled in us this desire to know him and love him on the intellectual, but also in the depths of our heart. Father Luis Miguel has responded to that call, listening to his dreams that the Lord has planted in his heart and in his mind. Whenever we respond to what God puts there, then our life will always be a wonderful life. Thanks for being with us today. As Catholics responding to the challenge of Bishop Barris to encourage dramatic missionary growth in the diocese, we use all forms of media in promoting the gospel, including television and social media. If you want to know more about any of the priests we featured here or have any questions or comments, you can email us at vocations@drvc.org, or you can visit our website at acalltoholiness.com. See you next time right here on It's a Wonderful Life.